So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this edition of the NITheP Colloquium. and let me mention now, because we will soon start a campaign to transition from NITheP to NITEX, which will be the National Institute for Theoretical and Computational Sciences, so that very soon this series will be called the NITEX Colloquium series. Yeah. And this afternoon, we are very fortunate to have Professor Dariusz Chruscinski with us. Dariusz is based at the Nicolaus Copernicus University in Torun, and at the moment he's the head of the Department of Mathematical Physics at that university. And Dariusz has worked mainly in mathematical physics. He's one of the strongholds of open quantum systems, entanglement theory, and so on and so forth. He wrote also a fantastic book on geometric phases that was published not so long ago, I remember. And more importantly, he's also the editor of two prestigious journals, Reports on Mathematical Physics, and Open Systems and Information Dynamics, which is probably the historically longest journal dedicated to open systems that I know of. So we are very grateful to Dariusz for all his activities. Yep. One of the reasons that I asked today Dariusz to speak at the NITEP Colloquium, and that is that unfortunately just almost 2 months ago, Professor Kosakowski, who's one of the fathers probably of the theory of open quantum systems, and everybody working in the field knows about him, died because of COVID. Yeah? And so I asked Dariusz maybe to give us a colloquium also in his memory, and Dariusz will say a few words about that just now. Yeah. So please, Dariusz, we are very, very happy to have you with us this afternoon, and you're most and welcome to start now with your presentation. And the usual rules of the webinars apply. Please use the Q&A facility or raise your hand, and Ilya, who you also see on the panel, will moderate the questions after or during the talk if needed. So Dariusz, please, okay. You're welcome to start.
Francesco, thank you very much for your kind invitation.
Absolute pleasure.
You know, a great pleasure to be in Durban. And well, let me start that we have a special guest today. I mean, Ola Kosakowska, the daughter of Professor Kosakowski, is with us. So Ola, many thanks for joining us. Okay, so let me start to share my screen. Just a second. Okay, so
Maybe Dariusz, you want to share the? Oh yeah, fantastic! You could read my talks. Yeah.
Okay, so my idea is to talk about the recent. Well, basically, this was the last common project with Professor Kosakowski. We started some time ago. Also with Gen Kimura. Maybe he is also at the audience. And Kimura spent, I guess, more than 1 year as a postdoc with Professor Kosakowski, more than 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago. And Yasuhito Shishido, I think PhD student of Gen Kimura both of them from Shibuara Institute of Technology. So it was really terrible news I got from actually from Vittorio Gorini on February 1st, early morning. I got an email from Vittorio that Andrzej is no longer with us, and Vittorio got a call in the middle of the night from Ola Kosakowska that Andrzej Kosakowski passed away. So many of you know his celebrated results on quantum dynamical semigroups. Andrzej was a master of mathematical physics and contributed a lot to various subjects, not only to open quantum systems, but also to quantum statistical mechanics, quantum chaos, quantum ergodicity, work also on quantum information, quantum entanglement operator algebras, quantum entropies, quantum probability and related things. But of course, his most celebrated papers were devoted to open quantum systems, especially Markovian semigroups. So let me refresh your memory about one of the key paper of Andrzej, which was published in 72 in Reports on Mathematical Physics and entitled on Quantum Statistical Mechanics on Non-Hamiltonian Systems. And actually in this very paper, he provided a beautiful axiomatic approach to Markovian semigroups. And basically in the same year, in another journal, actually it was Bulletin of Polish Academy of Sciences. He published a very small paper, just few pages, on necessary and sufficient conditions for a generator of a quantum dynamical semigroup. And this is absolutely beautiful paper based on a mathematical approach of Lumer and Phillips, very abstract approach to semigroups. So using this approach, he was able to derive necessary and sufficient conditions for a generator of a dynamical semigroup. But of course it was, you know, it was 72. So at that time, a majority of people working on that meant by dynamical semigroup a family of positive maps, right? Only positive. The notion of completely positive was still not very popular among physicists. And actually, after deriving this result, he was completely stuck. Well, because, you know, the conditions were derived, but there was no any method to construct a generator which satisfy these conditions. So, you know, it was very, very beautiful mathematical, mainly mathematical result, but completely unpractical from the physical point of view. And at that time, he was invited by Hermann Haken to visit his group in Stuttgart. At that time, he met Vittorio Gorini, who just came back from Austin, Texas, where he spent almost 2 years with George Sudarshan, basically studying very similar problems. And then a very fruitful collaboration started between Vittorio and Andrzej Kosakowski. So because Vittorio already knew George Sudarshan very well, he started to talk about his joint work with Andrzej, and they were both invited to Austin. And meanwhile, Vittorio realized the very concept of complete positivity, because it was 73. There was very, very important conference in Marburg, in Germany. And Vittorio Gorini participated in the conference. And during the conference, he listened to the talk of Karl Kraus. And after the talk, it was clear that it is a notion of complete positivity, not just positivity, which is important. And when they realized about this very notion of complete positivity, they were very quick to derive the necessary condition for the generator of completely positive dynamical map, which was published in this seminal famous paper with Vittorio and George Sudarshan. This is a structure of the generator everybody knows, right? So let me share with you a photo which was taken in Torun in December 1975 in the office of Professor Ingarden on the left, who was at the time the head of Department of Mathematical Physics. So we see Andrzej, George, and Vittorio. Okay. So let me start with this beautiful structure of Gorini-Kosakowski-Sudarshan-Lindblad generator. Of course, you recognize two characteristic parts of the generator. I mean, Hamiltonian part with self-adjoint operator, which is usually considered as a kind of effective Hamiltonian. And we have, you know, this extra piece, which we call dissipative part. Well, my talk will be very simple from the mathematical point of view. I will consider only finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. Some of the results probably can be generalized to infinite dimensions as well. Okay, so this is a structure of the generator. But of course, you know that this structure, this representation is highly non-unique. This L operators are usually called Lindblad or just noise operators. And of course, you recognize this piece of the generator, which using this, we can define completely positive map. This is just Kraus representation. And using the Hilbert-Schmidt inner product, having a completely positive map phi, you can define the dual, denoted by, you know, this double dagger. And using the dual, you can find very, very compact representation. So this formula shows that basically L is fully characterized if you know the effective Hamiltonian and a single completely positive map, capital phi, right? Okay. So as you know, we have two equivalent pictures in quantum mechanics, Schrödinger and Heisenberg. So we can also analyze these two pictures just studying evolution of an open quantum system. So in the Schrödinger picture, we have just this representation. This is a representation of a dynamical map. The map is trace preserving. The corresponding property of the generator is that it kills the trace of an operator. And equivalently, you may consider the Heisenberg picture. This is a representation of the Heisenberg picture for quantum channel, time-dependent quantum channel. The characteristic property of the Heisenberg picture is that the identity operator is invariant under the action of the map. And the corresponding property of the generator is that it kills the identity operator. Okay, good. And of course, you remember how to characterize positivity. We have this beautiful observation by Choi, who observes that complete positivity can be fully characterized by a spectral property of this operator, which we usually call the Choi matrix. So you define a maximally entangled state. Psi P is corresponding rank one projector. And you apply the map identity tensor phi onto this projector, and complete positivity means that this operator, result of the action of this map on P, is positive. So you know, it's a beautiful miraculous result, telling us that in order to check for complete positivity, it's enough to check positivity on one operator, right? Absolutely fantastic. And we have quite analogous result, which characterizes Gorini-Kosakowski Sudarshan Minden generator. Actually, we take the same projector. We extend generator by identity map, right? We apply to projector P. And then we sandwich with orthogonal projector, right? And L is legitimate generator of a dynamical semigroup if and only if this operator is positive. Sometimes, well, especially mathematicians call operator which enjoys this property conditionally completely positive, right? Because it's not completely positive, only after projecting onto the orthogonal subspace. It is positive, right? Okay. So again, the basic structure of the generator. And as you know, complete positivity is fully characterized by this property. Small gammas are positive constants, right? But of course, you know that while this is a very simple condition, but this is purely mathematical condition because, you know, these quantities, sometimes we call them, well, sometimes people call them dissipation or decoherence rates. But of course, it's not true. They are not decoherence rates because this representation is not unique. So these are not physical quantities. You cannot measure gammas in the laboratory. So the point is that we have beautiful mathematical representation. We have very simple condition, but you know, somehow this condition cannot be checked in the laboratory because these are not measurable quantities. So the problem we pose, formulate a more natural condition for complete positivity in terms of quantities which are measurable in the laboratory. And as you know, what is usually measured in the laboratory is very much related to the spectrum of operator or the spectrum of the map. So let me refresh your memory about the spectrum of the generator, because the generator preserves hermeticity. The spectrum is symmetric with respect to real line, right? So if L is complex, L complex conjugate, L belongs to the spectrum as L. There is a leading eigenvalue. I denote it by L zero, L naught, which is zero, and the corresponding eigenvector to L naught is positive definite. So after appropriate normalization, it can be considered as a legitimate density operator, and the remaining eigenvalues enjoy this property. The trial part is never positive. Because of that, you can easily define capital gamma, right, which is minus real part of L, and we call it relaxation rate. People working in the laboratory often prefer, instead of using relaxation rate, to use relaxation times, but they are related, they are just inverses of relaxation rates. And actually, these quantities are measurable, can be measured in the laboratory. Easy relaxation rates or relaxation times. So our problem is how to characterize complete positivity in terms of these quantities, which are measurable. So once again, usually, the condition for complete positivity is formulated in terms of small gammas, because it's very simple, right? However, it is not very much related to the experiment. Our problem is how to replace this purely mathematical condition, but by a more physical one, formulated in terms of relaxation rates. And to illustrate this, let me start with a very simple example, very simple generator for the qubit evolution. Sigmas are, of course, Pauli matrices. And of course, we know the condition for complete positivity, small gammas are non-negative. But look, in this case, it's very easy to compute the relaxation rates, capital gammas. These are formulas for relaxation rates. And of course, we know that they are non-negative, right? And look, if you consider the evolution of the density operator, which is generated by L, it's very easy to do this, especially if you use this well-known Bloch representation. So this is the evolution, time evolution of the Bloch vector. Because capital gammas are non-negative, you see that if the initial Bloch vector belongs to the Bloch ball, it stays within the Bloch ball. So for sure, the evolution is positive because the positivity of density operator is preserved. But of course, positivity of capital gammas, this condition is not enough for complete positivity. It guarantees only positivity. So because complete positivity requires that small gammas are non-negative, not capital gammas. So it's very easy to translate this condition as a following condition for capital gammas, right? Now look, if I define the total rate, the sum of all rates, gamma one plus gamma two plus gamma three, these three conditions, somehow independent conditions, have the universal structure that each single relaxation rate is upper bounded by half of total rate, right? So this is a condition of complete positivity, but formulated in terms of quantities which you can measure in the laboratory. Okay, let me comment on another example, which was already considered in the seminar paper by Copernicus and Sudarshan. You recognize very, very general qubit generator. You have Hamiltonian part and three characteristic quantum processes. Decoherence generated by LZ, decoherence with respect to eigenbasis of sigma z. And to the two processes, L plus, which generates, pumping from ground state to excited state, and reverse process, I mean dissipation from the excited state to the ground state, L minus. And again, it's complete positivity means that gamma plus, gamma minus, and gamma z are non-negative, but these are not measurable quantities. What we can measure are relaxation rates. So people define a transversal rate, gamma t. Very easy exercise to check. And longitudinal rate, gamma plus gamma minus. Again, the same formulas. And now look, if I again define total rate, then conditions for complete positivity, I mean, that gamma plus is non-negative, gamma minus, and gamma z non-negative, can be again reformulated in this universal form that any single relaxation rate is upper bounded by half of total rate. And actually, this evolution is very often represented as a set of well-known Bloch equations. And in particular, complete positivity is manifested in this well-known relation between longitudinal and transversal relaxation times, which was already very well tested in several experiments. Actually, to stay within a Bloch ball, you can violate this relation, and still the evolution is positive. However, if you violate this relation, the evolution cannot be completely positive. So this is necessary condition for complete positivity. Okay, actually, these two simple examples just illustrate a general property which was proved by Gen Kimura almost 20 years ago. He proved that for any qubit link blood generator, if you define a total rate, that any single rate enjoy this universal constraint. And actually, the proof is very simple because you know there are only two possibilities. Either you have two complex eigenvalues which are mutually conjugate, then you have transversal rate, and of course lambda 3 has to be real. Easier, you have three real eigenvalues. Anyway, complete positivity means that these conditions has to be satisfied, which can be immediately translated into this upper bound for each relaxation rate. So it was proof for a qubit generator. Okay, more than 10 years ago, Wolf and Sirach made the following observation. They consider purely dissipative generator, so without Hamiltonian part. And they prove that operator norm is upper bounded by 2 gamma over D. Again, gamma is the total rate. So using a simple chain of inequalities, you can infer that any single rate is upper bounded by 2 gamma over D. And then Gen Kimura with collaborators again prove that you can improve this bound. So they prove that for any generator, not necessarily purely dissipative, you have the following, the following constraint. So any single rate is upper bounded by square root of 2 over D times total relaxation rate gamma. And our goal or our idea was to prove the following result. Direct generalization for the qubit result, right? That if the dimension of the Hilbert space is D, then complete positivity necessarily requires that any single relaxation rate, gamma k, is upper bounded by gamma, total rate gamma over D. Well, so I have to stress that we do not have a proof. It is still a conjecture. Maybe during my talk, you will realize that it is trivially true or trivially false. So just please let me know. So we as I said, we do not have a proof. Okay, this is again just the same conjecture. But you see, it can be even formulated in a more compact fashion if I define relative rates. So this is a rate divided by a total rate gamma. And this condition means that any single relative rate, Rk, is upper bounded by 1 over D. So any relative rate is between 0 and 1 over D. Very simple condition. Okay, so this is still a conjecture. However, it is supported by several examples and also by very nice numerical analysis. So let me show you this plot with some numerical analysis. So what this plot say? So vertical red line corresponds to our conjecture 1 over D. And blue line is a result proved by Gen Kimura, square root of 2 over D. So D equals 2, it was already proved that the the red vertical line provides correct bound. However, as you see, numerically, it seems that, well, the conjecture works. This is the plot for D equals 3. Again, we have a red bound conjectured, and blue bound was already proved. Again, D equals 4. Red bound conjectured, blue bound already proved, and the same for D equals 5. So there is a nice support from simple numerics. Okay, so this bulks of points is just spectrum of randomly chosen Lindblad generator, right? Okay. So what I'm going to tell you is that this is a conjecture bound. I will show you that this bound is tight, cannot be improved. It is true for a classical generator. I will explain what does it mean. It is true for unital semigroups, true for Davis generators, which as you might remember, plays a key role in physical applications. And moreover, if the conjecture is true, it would imply a series of very nice implications. If I have time, I will tell you about that. Let me check time. Okay. Now you can see Professor Kosakowski lecturing. It was during 44th symposium, almost 10 years ago. In Torun, we had special symposium devoted to open quantum systems. There were a lot of young people at the audience. And you may recognize the characteristic style of Andrzej Kosakowski. Actually, this densely filled slide, you know, is the essence of open quantum systems, right? You recognize, you know, the interaction part of the Hamiltonian unitary evolution of the whole system. Partial trace, I mean reduced evolution, and you know the very notion of complete positivity, CP, right? And this was the photo taken 5 years ago during the also symposium on mathematical physics. This was a special symposium because it was we got the idea to organize a symposium to honor this beautiful results of this gentleman, exactly 40 years after publication of Torini, Kosakowski, Sudarshan, and Lindblad paper. And a lot of prominent people joined the symposium. So I hope that you recognize a lot of friends. So you see Francesco in the audience, especially strong Italian group, right? And of course, three heroes, right? Andrzej Kosakowski, Vittorio Corini, and George Sudarshan. Now you might know that George Sudarshan also passed away in May 2018. The wife of George Sudarshan, Luigi Accardi, Saverio Pascazio, Robert Alitsky, a strong Italian group, Fabio Benatti, Massimo Palma, other people, Pepe Marmo. Also, Reinhard Werner was with us. A lot of very influential people for upper quantum systems and quantum information. Okay, so let me move on. This famous photo was taken during the conference. It was last meeting of these famous three guys in Torun. Okay. Now let me show you that this bound cannot be improved. It's very easy. Just take arbitrary Hermitian operator. This is a spectral representation. And let me define the following generator. If capital sigma is sigma z, you immediately recognize familiar generator of qubit decoherence, which has exactly the same structure. And for this generator, it's extremely simple to find relaxation rates. these arrays, right? S I is eigenvalue of sigma, right? And especially, well, the spectrum is completely arbitrary, does not matter. It works for any capital sigma. Now, if you take the spectrum as follows, right? Then you can compute that the maximal rate is exactly 1 over d times gamma. So you know this bound is saturated. So this example can show that the bound can be saturated, which means that it cannot be improved. Now we analyze, the same problem can be analyzed for classical generator. What I mean by that? In the classical case, you may consider a Markovian semigroup of stochastic matrices. The corresponding generator satisfies these properties, already characterized by Kolmogorov. So of diagonal elements are non-negative and, preservation of probability corresponds to this condition. Sorry, it should be zero, not one. Sorry for that, zero trace preservation, right? And of course, any Kolmogorov generator can be represented like this. And this is usually interpreted, this Tij are interpreted as just jumping rates from state J to state I, right? And this rates appear in just Pauli master equation. Okay. Again, in this case, you can define a classical relaxation rates. These are minus real parts of eigenvalues of the generator. Of course, eigenvalues are in general complex. However, what is important in the classical case, there are no restriction for relaxation rates. Then they can be completely arbitrary. Well, arbitrary, I mean, non-negative. If you give me a collection of positive numbers, d minus one positive numbers, because one of them is zero, of course. If you give me a collection of positive numbers, I can provide you a construction of Kolmogorov generator with these numbers as relaxation rate. However, if you consider this problem in the quantum language, and you require that this generator generates only the evolution of the diagonal of the density operator. But of course, you need also the evolution of diagonal elements. So you construct the following Klingblad generator, where Lij simply this operator. So for the trace preservation, you need to subtract this characteristic 1/2 of anti-commutator B with rho, where B is again defined in terms of Tij. So now we have D squared minus one relaxation rates. So part of the set is just the same as classical rates for Kolmogorov generator, which are completely arbitrary again. But now you have another set. Of course, this extra set, we may call it quantum relaxation rates. Of course, again, it is fully characterized by this classical rates. But now the miracle appears, because if you define the total rate, I mean sum of classical rates and quantum rates, then our conjecture is satisfied, because both classical rates are upper bounded by gamma over d, and quantum rates are upper bounded by gamma over d. So all rates satisfy our conjecture. Okay. Well, of course, you may consider the spectral problem on the level of Schrödinger or Heisenberg generator, does not matter. Spectra are the same. In case of Schrödinger evolution, of course, you know that each generator has characteristic invariant state, denoted here by omega. on the level of Heisenberg picture, we know that the invariant operator is always corresponds to identity operator. Now, you might remember that basically the same result was derived by Lin, but he took completely different approach. Namely, he observed that it is very useful to use the following property of the generator. He called it the dissipativity. So we call a generator dissipative if and only if the generator satisfies the following condition. K dissipativity means that if you extend by K dimensional ancilla, the extension is dissipative. And complete dissipativity means that any extension is dissipative. Now, what Lindblad proved is that, well, what we call GKLS generator is equivalent to complete dissipativity. On the level of the map, dissipativity means that the map satisfies famous Cadison-Schwarz inequality, this type of inequality, right? So any completely positive map satisfies that kind of inequality. However, there are positive maps which violate this inequality. For example, transposition. Transposition does violate. Yes. Okay, so now let me start with this condition for dissipativity. Again, the same condition. Now, if the generator has GKLS form, then this condition is trivially satisfied because the left-hand side of this inequality has this form. So it's trivially positive because small gammas are non-negative, right? Okay, so taking this very structure, we were able to prove the following nice observation. Okay, so we are working in the Heisenberg picture. So this is a spectral problem. Eigenvectors and eigenvalues, relaxation rate, minus real part of eigenvalue. Of course, in the Schrödinger picture, we know the invariant state. Knowing the invariant state, people often define the following inner product, right? And knowing the inner product, I can define a norm, right? And using this object, I mean the norm defined in terms of an invariant state, we were able to prove that any relaxation rate satisfies the following, can be computed via this formula. Right. This is a Lindblad operator from the generator, eigenvectors, and the omega norm, right? Some result how to compute the rate. Okay, now using this, maybe I skip this calculations. Okay, now I take a very special scenario. I assume that the invariant state is maximally mixed, which means that the semigroup is unital, right? So the generator, not only the dual generator kills identity, but the generator itself kills identity. So this formula for the rate, now you see that omega norm is nothing but Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So that this condition, this universal condition simplifies in this case to the following condition where this norm is simply Hilbert-Schmidt norm. Okay. And what we did, we use the following very intricate inequality, which was proved by Butcher and Wenzel more than 10 years ago. The inequality is tight. Okay, and using what this inequality says, and this inequality says that Hilbert-Schmidt norm of a commutator of arbitrary two operators is upper bounded by twice the norm of A times norm of B, very intricate result. Basically, using this inequality, we were able to prove that for any unital semigroup, our conjecture holds. Right. So we have a large class of systems for which this conjecture is satisfied. And there is another important class. These are generators which enjoy the following covariance property. So we take a family of, okay, if you fix a basis in the Hilbert space, then you may define a family of unitary operators which are diagonal in this basis. And covariance property means that the generator does commute with sandwiching with this unitaries. Okay. So what we proved that generators which enjoy this covariance property also satisfy our conjecture. I have some comments on this, but I skip it. What is important that there is very important class of generators which found very important applications of physics. And these are generators which can be derived in the celebrated weak coupling limit, right? So you start with composite quantum system, I mean system plus environment. You make a lot of assumptions that the interaction is weak, that there is a separation of characteristic time scales of the system and environment, and using this celebrated Van Hove or weak coupling limit, you derive the structure of the generator. And actually, the generator in the weak coupling limit enjoy this covariance property. That's why it satisfies our conjecture. And actually, majority of Markovian semigroups are considered by physicists belongs to this class. So this, I would say, physical class of generator enjoys this nice universal constraints. Okay, 2 years ago, Professor Andrzej Kosakowski was awarded a prize of foundation of Polish science. This is most prestigious scientific prize in Poland. That's why very often we call it Polish Nobel Prize. What are the possible implications of our conjecture? Let me comment of two of them. The conjecture would imply interesting properties of spectra of quantum channels. This is one implication, and the second one is very much related to so-called one-shot Markovianity of the channel. The problem is, given a channel, is it possible to represent the channel as the exponential of the lambda generator? I will comment on that briefly. What about spectra of channels? Okay, so this is our conjecture. Let me take arbitrary quantum channel. If I subtract identities, this is legitimate lambda generator. So, If this condition for the rates of the generator, if this condition is true, it immediately implies several conditions for the spectrum of the channel, right? Especially for the real part of the spectrum. This is a condition which reduces in the qubit case to this condition, which you may already recognize because it's very similar to the famous Algoed-Fujiwara condition for the Pauli quantum channels. Let me comment on that. Any qubit channel can be represented by 4×4 real matrix, right? This delta is 3×3 real, right? So if I take signed singular values of delta, then this is necessary condition for this map to be completely positive, be a channel. Moreover, if this shift vector x is, if the channel is unital, which means that there is no shift, x is zero, then this condition is not only necessary, but also sufficient. In particular, there is a nice class of channels, which are unital, I mean Pauli channels, defined in terms of Pauli matrices. So in this case, the delta is diagonal. And it was already recognized in the late 90s of the last century that necessary and sufficient condition for complete positivity can be formulated in terms of lambdas. But in the case of Pauli channels, eigenvalues are real. So this condition is equivalent to the condition for which is implied by our conjecture for qubits. And the second implication, it was Michael Wolff and collaborators who formulated this problem and were able to provide some very, very interesting insight how the problem is very hard. Actually, they proved that it is NP-hard, given a channel to decide whether or not can be represented in this form. They prove it that it is an NP-hard problem. But look, if I assume that this condition is satisfied, right? So knowing eigenvalues of the generator, I assume that the relaxation rates enjoy this property. So of course, I know the eigenvalues of the channel. Well, if this representation is true, right? So I'm looking for necessary condition. I assume that it is true to represent a channel via exponentiating of the Lindlandian, right? So knowing the eigenvalue, knowing the spectrum of L, I know the spectrum of phi by simple exponentiation. So I compute the determinant, right? To compute the determinant, I have to multiply all eigenvalues, okay? But using this definitions, this is nothing but exponent of minus gamma. Gamma is the total rate. Okay, now the total rate enjoys this property. Okay, so this exponent is upper bounded by this one, but this one is nothing but the absolute value of the alpha to the power d. And this gives me very, very nice constraint for the absolute value of any eigenvalue of the channel. It's upper bounded by one, but this is trivial because, you know, due to this famous Frobenius-Perron theorem, all eigenvalues of the quantum channel belongs to the unit disk. But there is a lower bound for each absolute value of Z, which of course depends on the channel. And the lower bound is very simple. You have to compute the determinant and compute the power of determinant, one over D, right? So, you know, the structure of the spectrum has very nice property because any channel, the structure of the spectrum of any channel is the following. All eigenvalues belong to the unit disk. But here you have a kind of, well, and people call it Frobenius-Perron disk. But now we have a kind of, you know, of a ring because we have an outer disk of radius one and inner disk of this radius, right? So a necessary condition to satisfy for the channel to be one shot Markovian is that all eigenvalues belong to, well, let me call it Frobenius-Perron ring, right? Between identity as this number, which depends on the channel. So these are the main implications. So let me summarize. If you do this for the qubit channel, for example, Pauli channel, you recover such relations between eigenvalues, and actually these relations were recently observed independently by these people, but using completely different, of course, completely different methods. Okay, so let me conclude. It was again Kimura who is a co-author of this presentation, who proves that for any qubit Lindblad generator, such property is satisfied. Our intention was to generalize it for arbitrary quantum D-level quantum system. I stress that we still do not have a proof. However, we have nice numerical support. Moreover, we check a lot of important examples. In particular, a class of physical generators obtained in the weak coupling limit. All of them satisfy this universal condition. Well, moreover, if this condition is true, it implies very nice. It has very nice implications, for example, for spectra of channels and for the problem to decide whether or not the channel is one-shot Markovian. If you are interested, we have a small manuscript on that, which was posted on the archive a few months ago. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Darius, thank you very much for an excellent talk. And also, thank you very much for celebrating the memory of Professor Kosakowski. We will all remember him as a very important contributor to many fields of mathematical physics. I would like to ask Ilya now if there are any questions. And if not, I will remind the participants to please raise either to use the Q&A facility or to raise their hand to attract our attention so that we can give you the right to speak and ask your questions. Ilya, will you guide us through this process, please?
Yes, of course. So far, there is no questions in Q&A. And maybe while people thinking, I can ask a quick question.
Please.
Sorry, Dariusz, but do you know an example of the semigroup generator which is not in your categories, like which is not physical? Kind of, what would be the example of something which is outside of those classes, but where you can, for example, calculate the spectrum and analyze it?
No, if you take randomly. Of course, it's outside.
Ah, okay. Okay, so just arbitrary random, yeah?
Yes, arbitrary random, of course, it's outside because, well, it does not enjoy any covariance, nothing like that. It's outside.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
And okay, maybe then while people think, I can ask Darius also a question. And Darius, is there any chance that some similar inequality hold in some non-Markovian sense?
Yes. Of course, it's another implication. Now you can define local relaxation rates, right? Mm.
Yeah.
So the speed of relaxation is not constant. It's time dependent, right? You can define the local relaxation rate. So if this condition is true, so violation of this condition would imply that the evolution is not so-called CP divisible, right? Mm-hmm. If you violate this.
Okay. Thank you. That's very nice.
So this would be, preservation of this condition would be necessary to have Markovian evolution. It would be necessary condition.
Yeah. Okay. That's very nice. Yeah. So there are a lot of potential.
Yes.
And Ilya, I see now the question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a question by Camille, and he's asking, thanks for the very interesting talk. One of the motivation was to obtain a criterion which can be tested experimentally. Are you aware of any experiments verifying your conjecture?
Yeah, nice question. Yeah.
Well, of course, I know about, you know, some experiments verifying this relation between longitudinal and transversal relaxation time. So this is partial, well, but it was for qubit. So for qubit, the conjecture was already proven, right? So somehow, you know, this results somehow, you know, say that, well, what is observed in the experiment is perfectly consistent with the theoretical prediction. Concerning higher level systems, I don't know. It's a very good point. We have to more check much more the experimental literature about that. Very good point. Thank you.
Okay. And sorry, Dariusz, but in the weak coupling limit, you say that the conjecture is satisfied, but in other limits, when you can define GKSL generator, like for example, in singular coupling limit, is it also satisfied?
Of course, good, very good question. well, very good question. We did not check, right? We did not check. Not check. I'm pretty sure that it is true, but we did not check. Good point. Thank you.
Okay, and there is a raised arm by Michael Mlaba. Okay, I will allow him to talk just now. Hi, Michael. You can talk.
Thank you also for this very interesting talk. I would like to find out if you're aware if this condition can also be satisfied in cases where the small gamma decay rates they are negative.
Yes. Well, in principle, yes. In principle, yes, because you know, this is only necessary condition, right? So even if some it might. Well, probably you can devise, you can devise some example, some malicious example in which some small gamma is negative, but still the condition for capital gamma is satisfied because the condition for small gammas is necessary and sufficient. And the condition for capital gammas, which we derived, is only necessary. So it may happen that some of small gamma is negative, but still, this condition is satisfied, right? Good point. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's not difficult to construct the example.
Yeah. Okay. I do not see any other questions and there is no raised arms. Over to you, Francesco.
Okay, then, and we've already passed five. So it's my pleasure again to thank Dariusz very, very much for really an excellent talk. It was really, really interesting. And I would like to thank also all the participants. And and I would like to express on behalf of the participants our sincere condolences to the daughter of Professor Kosakowski that has kindly joined us this afternoon. So thank you very much again, and I wish you all a good evening, and please stay all still safe because we are not yet all vaccinated. Yeah, so. Let's end on that note. Yeah. So thank you very much. Have a good evening. Thank you. Thank you, Dariusz.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for the invitation.
No. It was really very nice. Thank you very much, Dariusz. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you very much.